At some point in your life, you've probably been sick. Maybe it was that rotten milk you drank, or the moldy cheesecake you swore was worth it. What? You've never eaten moldy cheesecake? Guess that's just me. Well, you probably had the flu or a cold or even had a fever. There are some deadly diseases out there, like cholera, Ebola, and the plague. Prior to modern medicine, even the flu virus was especially deadly. Even today, many people die due to infectious diseases. In 6.2, we learn about the incredible ticking machine called the heart and the blood system. 6.3 is a natural follow-up to that topic. Our bodies are incredibly adapted to fight off diseases and infections. Bacteria, viruses, parasites, and fungi can all make us sick. Our bodies are programmed to fight back. If you recall from 6.2, we learned that leukocytes, better known as white blood cells, roam the body's blood vessels, staying on alert for foreign invaders. There's not just one type of leukocyte, there are many. You can see in the images here that these are just 12 of the examples of types of white blood cells. Some of these respond quickly, like neutrophils. Others deal only with parasites and pests, like eosinophils. Others will respond by creating inflammation and pain, like basophils. And others are the heavy-duty responders, coordinating with other leukocytes. These are the macrophages, monocytes, and lymphocytes. We will focus on these guys a lot today. So, welcome to 6.3, Defense Against Infectious Diseases. The essential idea, which you've hopefully gathered by this point, is that the human body has structures and processes that resist the continuous threat of invasion by pathogens. So let's learn more about our lean, mean pathogen fighting machine we call the immune system. Let's throw down a few basics before we get into the mix too much. First, we shall discuss pathogens and the methods of transmission. A pathogen is any organism that causes a disease or infection. You can see from the image here that we have some examples of pathogens. Simply stated, pathogens can be bacteria, viruses, protozoa, or fungi. You will also see the term prokaryote tossed around with bacteria because prokaryotes are the specific types of cells. Remember from evolution that all bacteria have prokaryotic cells, and eukarya, including animals and humans, have eukaryotic cells. Bacteria can be anything from pneumonia or streptococcus. Viruses can be things like varicella, HIV, or Ebola. Protozoa can be diseases like malaria or dysentery, or the STI trichomoniasis. Parasites include tapeworms, scabies, lice, and Giardia. Sounds like we just made a trip to the infectious disease zoo. Keep those diseases away from me. You probably already know that every infectious disease can be passed to another person or sometimes animal, and that different diseases have different transmission methods. For example, they can be passed via direct contact like varicella, or herpes. They can also be passed through infectious body fluids like mucus, sexual fluids, or saliva. Sometimes diseases can be passed via animal vectors like malaria and the rabies virus. Others need blood-to-blood contact, while others have to be ingested or swallowed, like salmonella. Infectious diseases are opportunistic, and any way they can get into your body, the better. I hate to burst your bubble, but the world is cruel and a dirty, dirty place filled with filth and disease. Luckily, our bodies are defenders of the crown and have different ways of fighting off these icky infectious diseases. Generally, our bodies have three basic lines of defense. The absolute first line of defense are the surface barriers, like the skin, mucous membranes, and secretion of these skin and membrane. If that doesn't work, the second line of defense is what we call the non-specific immune response, which are the internal fighters that are willing to go to battle to fight any pathogen. The third line of defense is the specific immune system, which is the most intricate and works in the most extenuating circumstances and helps our body's defense systems to make memory cells in case any similar pathogens come along later. So now that you have the basics, we are going to discuss the three lines of defense in more detail, starting with the first line of defense. As you can see here, the first line of defense against infectious diseases are the surface barriers that simply exist to prevent outside things from getting into the body. As you know, the skin is the outermost layer of our body. The skin itself protects the external structures of our body and consists of a dry, thick layer of mostly dead cells. This is important, as many pathogens require moist conditions in order to survive and thrive. Additionally, our sebaceous glands secrete chemicals and enzymes which inhibit microbial growth on skin. The skin also secretes lactic acid and fatty acids to lower the pH to 5.6 to 6.4, depending on the area of the body. This acidic condition also prevents some pathogens from surviving. Internally, we have mucus that helps to protect the internal structures, externally accessible cavities and tubes, such as trachea, esophagus, urethra, and others. These areas consist of a thin region of living cells that release fluids to wash away pathogens, so mucus, saliva, and tears. So really, runny noses and watery eyes seem annoying. These are actually signs your body is working correctly. Additionally, these areas contain special cells that secrete chemicals that break down the pathogen's cell walls. And along with physical actions of coughing and sneezing, these mucous membranes help the body to remove these pathogens. So what happens when our first line of defense gets pierced and cuts occur in the skin? As you know, our body works to respond, to stop the bleeding. The term clotting is the specific mechanism for how broken blood vessels are repaired when they get damaged. It's important to repair the skin, as the blood system is the transport system of our body. If an invader gets on board, they can move throughout the body. There are two huge benefits to blood clotting when the skin is cut. The first is to prevent blood loss from the body, and the second is to limit the access to the bloodstream by pathogens. It's that simple. The components of the blood clots are important, and you have probably heard of one of them. They are the platelets and the insoluble fibrin strands. As you know, our blood has platelets, which flow through in times of wonderfulness, looking to vessels that might be ruptured. When they come across a ruptured vessel, a series of events occurs called the coagulation cascade. When activated, platelets undergo a structural change to aid in the response, becoming sticky, as well as releasing what are called clotting factors. Let's talk all about the steps in the coagulation cascade, as you need to know and explain how this works. The coagulation cascade, the waterfall of actions that ends up with a sticky substance stopping the bleeding. The cascade is initiated by clotting factors released from damaged cells that surround the area and platelets themselves. This cascade has many, many steps, but I'm just going to highlight the important ones for you now. So follow along the diagram, and here we go. First, clotting factors released from the platelets and surrounding cells cause platelets to become sticky and adhere to the damaged region to form a solid plug. These factors also initiate localized vasoconstriction to reduce the blood flow through the damaged region. Remember that vasoconstriction is when the blood vessels get smaller. Additionally, clotting factors trigger the conversion of the inactive molecule called prothrombin into the activated enzyme thrombin. Thrombin, in turn, catalyzes the conversion of the soluble plasma protein fibrinogen into the insoluble fibrous form called fibrin, which literally look like small fibers, and as they are insoluble, cannot be broken down easily. The fibrin strands form a mesh of fibers around the platelet plug and traps blood cells to form a temporary clot. When the damaged region is completely repaired, an enzyme is activated to dissolve the clot. The resulting area is healed. Success! If you've ever had a cut and seen or touched the sticky substance that's there, it is the platelets and the clotting factors doing their magic. If you've ever heard about someone with a condition of hemophilia, this is a condition where something in the coagulation cascade is not functioning properly and the person has trouble stopping bleeding. However, sometimes these blood clots can be internal and negative. For example, in 6.2, we learned about the coronary arteries. These are the major arteries that surround the heart and provide the heart with nutrients and oxygen they need to survive. When these arteries become completely occluded, which means to block the artery, the tissue at the site of the blockage cannot get the things it needs, and the tissue dies, and a heart attack is caused. So when fatty deposits build up in our arteries, these significantly reduce the diameter of the lumen and restrict the blood flow. The restricted blood flow increases pressure in the artery and leads to damage in the arterial wall. The damaged region is repaired with a fibrous tissue, which significantly reduces the elasticity of the vessel wall. Remember that arteries contain both muscle and elastic tissue. As the smooth lining of the artery is progressively degraded, lesions form called atherosclerotic plaques. If these plaques rupture, blood clotting is triggered inside the vessel, forming a blood clot that restricts blood flow partially or completely. If the clot is dislodged, it becomes an embolus and can cause a blockage in a smaller arteriole. This is what an embolism is. We've already discussed coronary heart disease and the risk factors of an increased risk of coronary thrombosis and heart attack. Specifically, sometimes elevated levels of stress or exercise can cause a coronary thrombosis and lead to a blockage. So we have covered the first line of defense. Now on to the second line of defense. This line is called the innate immune system, which is nonspecific in its response. We have specific types of white blood cells called phagocytes, which are the principal component here. These phagocytes engulf and digest foreign bodies that it comes across in the blood system. Check out the GIF at the top right. What you see here is a small bacteria being chased by a phagocyte and eventually being engulfed and immobilized. Phagocytes like to give what I call the hug of death to foreign bodies. Phagocytes are not specific and don't discriminate between the types of pathogens. If it is a bacteria, it's coming in for the hug. Virus, giving it a hug. Really, you don't want a hug from this guy. The technical word for this hug of death is called phagocytosis. Let me briefly outline this process for you as it relates to the third line of defense. As I mentioned, these phagocytes circulate in the blood and can move into the body tissues in response to an infection. Damaged tissues release chemicals that are called histamines, which draw white blood cells to the site of an infection. This is like tissues of the body sounding the alarm. Pathogens are engulfed when cellular extensions surround the pathogen and then fuse to form an internal vesicle. The vesicle is then fused to a lysosome, and the pathogen is digested via enzymes in the lysosome that break down the components of the pathogen. Pathogen fragments, which are called antigens, may be presented on the surface of the phagocyte in order to stimulate the third line of defense. Other components of the innate immune system include inflammation, fever, and antimicrobial chemicals. So, if the second line of defense is the non-specific immune system, then the third line of defense is the specific line of defense. This is also known as the adaptive immune system and is extremely specific in response. This line differentiates between different pathogens and creates a response that is specific to the target. Additionally, this line of defense has the ability to develop immunological memories so that in the event of exposure to the same type of pathogen, the body can respond rapidly. The specific type of leukocyte in the third line of defense is the lymphocyte. I think this is easy to remember because of the lymph nodes or lymphatic system. These lymphocytes are the generals in the response and coordinate the response. There are specific types of lymphocytes as well, which are B lymphocytes and T lymphocytes. Remember, in the second line of defense, there are substances called antigens, which are substances that pathogens have that the body recognizes as foreign and will try to destroy. When phagocytic leukocytes engulf a pathogen, some will present the digested fragments, which are the antigens, on their surface. These antigen-presenting cells, called dendritic cells, migrate to the lymph nodes and activate specific helper T lymphocytes. The helper T cells then release chemicals to activate the particular B cell, which is capable of producing antibodies specific for the antigen. The activated B cell will divide and differentiate to form short-lived plasma cells that produce high amounts of the specific antibody. It's like a factory for developing one specific antibody. Antibodies will target the specific antigen, enhancing the capacity of the immune system to recognize and destroy the pathogen. A small proportion of activated B cells and activated T cells will develop into memory cells to provide long-lasting immunity, and these memory cells stay in the body for a long time. Remember from the last image, you can see that the antibody is a Y shape, and each antibody is built with a specific antigen-binding site. One practical application of this is the development of vaccines to fight off viruses. Typically, vaccines are weakened or dead virus cells that are injected into our body so our body has exposure to the specific pathogen and can create memory cells in the event of future exposure to the antigens. For example, if you've ever had a varicella vaccination, your body was exposed to chickenpox, and you will likely never have a severe case of the virus in your lifetime. Some vaccinations require a booster shot in order to refresh our memory cells. An example of this is a tetanus shot, which should be given roughly every 10 years. So we all have these pathogens, and we have our three lines of defense. For the majority of our lifetime, these lines of defense are good enough. However, technology and modern medicine have come up with ways to help humans and animals fight pathogens. When we talk about viruses, I just mentioned vaccines. With bacteria, we have antibiotics. Antibiotics are compounds that kill or inhibit the growth of bacterial microbes by targeting prokaryotic metabolism. In short, antibiotics mess with the life cycle of bacteria. You can see the bacteria in the image to the right, which features of bacteria are targeted by antibiotics. Metabolic features that may be targeted include key enzymes, 70S ribosomes, and components of the cell wall. Because eukaryotic cells, which are the cells that humans have, don't possess these features, antibiotics will target the pathogenic bacteria and not the infected host. Antibiotics may either kill the invading bacteria or suppress its potential to reproduce. They might also be narrow, targeting one type of bacteria, or they might be broad and kill many bacteria, hoping to get rid of the pathogen in the process. As viruses do not have these structures or metabolism as bacteria do, they cannot be targeted or affected by antibiotics. So if you have a virus and take antibiotics, they are useless. They can be treated with antiviral agents, however, which target specific parts of the virus's life cycle. One really important thing to discuss is the tie to evolution. Remember that in 5.2, we talked about natural selection and that organisms respond and adapt to their environment. We studied the specific case about MRSA, which is an example of a bacteria that has become resistant to certain antibiotics due to being exposed, and some mutations surviving and reproducing, passing their genetic code and resistance to their offspring. Antibiotic-resistant strains have increased in humans due to a few reasons. First, antibiotics are often overprescribed or misused. Many antibiotics are freely available without a prescription, and certain antibiotics are commonly included in livestock feed. Multidrug-resistant bacteria are especially common in hospitals, where antibiotic use is high. It's potentially very dangerous, as a pathogen that is resistant to many antibiotics, called a superbug, could potentially cause excessive harm to the worldwide population if it spreads. The issue is important enough to warrant campaigns for people to not take antibiotics improperly or when they are not necessary. Like if you have a virus, it's important for doctors to know this as well. So where did antibiotics come from? Let's dive into the brief history of this and talk about Florian Chain's experiments. The first antibiotic to be discovered was penicillin by Alexander Fleming in 1928. Penicillin itself is a mold, and Fleming noticed that on a bacterial plate that the mold grew and the bacteria did not grow near to it. So he concluded that the mold was releasing some substance that was killing the nearby Staphylococcus bacteria. However, penicillin was not widely used until 1942. In order for this, penicillin needed to be studied more. The scientist Howard Florey and Ernst Chain tested penicillin on mice. They injected 8 mice with a Streptococcus strain of bacteria. 4 of the mice were injected with doses of penicillin, the other 4 were not. All 4 of the untreated mice died, and the 4 treated mice survived. It was groundbreaking and unlocked the potential of antibiotics. All 3 scientists, Florey, Chain, and Fleming, were awarded the Nobel Prize for Medicine in 1945. You can argue that many humans would not be around today had it not been for antibiotics. Today, we can synthesize and create new varieties of antibiotics, but this is slowing down, and this is potentially concerning with the emergence of antibiotic-resistant bacteria. Evolution in action. The last important application of this topic is the specific look at the human immunodeficiency virus, commonly known as HIV. HIV is a retrovirus that infects helper T cells, disabling the body's adaptive and specific immune system. HIV specifically targets the helper T lymphocytes, which regulate the adaptive immune system. Following infection, the virus undergoes a period of inactivity, which is called latency, during which infected helper T cells reproduce. Eventually, the virus becomes active again and begins to spread, destroying the T lymphocytes in the process. With the reduction in the number of helper T cells, antibodies are unable to be produced, resulting in a lowered immunity. The body becomes really susceptible to opportunistic infections, and eventually this results in death if the condition is not managed. When a person's immune system is so compromised that they're not able to fight these opportunistic infections off, they're said to have AIDS, which is acquired immunodeficiency syndrome. This can be tested for by looking at a person's T cell count. You can see in the bottom left how HIV can be spread. The virus can be spread through sexual contact, pregnancy, childbirth, breastfeeding, injection drug use, occupational exposure, or blood or organ transplants. The last 2 are extremely uncommon these days. HIV has likely been present in the human population since the early 1900s, but scientists are not totally sure. The virus itself was not discovered until 1983 after it became widespread and began impacting humans during an epidemic. Many misconceptions and stereotypes come from the sheer terror and panic that people felt, as first the disease was not known what it was, and then there were no treatment options. However, now people with HIV can take a series of antiretroviral treatments that disable the virus and enable people to have no trace of HIV in their bodies. But you can see there are challenges that are faced, like the expense of the treatment, continued discrimination for those living healthy lives with the virus, economic consequences, particularly in developing countries where the virus is prevalent, and an increase in the number of orphans. It's a fascinating case study, and we'll look into this during class, but I encourage you to read and watch documentaries about the disease. To recap this lecture, we have learned all about the way the body fights off foreign invaders and a few applications of this. Overall, this is a great tie back to 6.2 and the blood system. As always, it's really important to give credit where it's due. While the presentation script and video are solely of my own creation, many of the images and information contained in the presentation are not. So shout outs to the following: Most of the images and video clips came from IB BioNinja, and some of the information used. Other images and info come from Bionology, iBiology, and Biology for Life. Lastly, some information was gleaned from the Cambridge edition of the IB Biology text, as the intended purpose of this presentation is to provide you with yet another resource tool to enhance your learning for the IB Biology curriculum. So, peace out.